Thank you, Franz. Thank you, everybody. It's a great pleasure to be here. First time I speak in front of so many. Normally, we have like four or five attending the Python course. So, hour for my employer. As Franz mentioned, I work at SUAT, which is, for those of you who work in the University of Zurich, the division in the central IT services that takes care of providing IT services for research. So from computational clusters, the cloud, also assistance in writing programs for doing trainings like this. So if you have any of these needs, you are very welcome to come to our offices and have a chat. Okay, just a quick question, so to know a bit about the audience. Raise your hand, who has done some programming at some point? So, okay, who has done programming in Python? A bit less. And for those who have done programming in Python, so have you modified a script that someone else did, or did you write something from scratch? Okay. Okay, so prerequisite, I presume, and that's not far from what people have shown raising hands, that everybody has a notion of how to program a computer. So you have done some programming in MATLAB, in R, in other languages. So I'm going to show the basic syntax of Python. So this is how we do a for loop in Python. This is how we do a while loop. But I'm not telling you when to use a while loop or a for loop. We won't fit that into an hour and a half. So it might take a while to lay down the basics, but then the more interesting stuff can come. If you're new to the Python world, there's still, nowadays, a sort of division, in that there are two major versions of Python around, Python version 2 and Python version 3. They are almost the same language, but not literally compatible. So if your code runs on Python 3, will not run on Python 2, but also vice versa. So you need really to take care to write code that can run unmodified in both interpreters. We are going to use Python 2 for this tutorial. I will point out differences. If you're going to start a project from scratch, it's probably the wisest choice to start with Python 3, but always check what version of Python is supported by the libraries you want to use. So that's been a hindrance so far, that libraries take a while to be imported. Okay, ideally, the talk is divided in three parts, and there's also three notebooks to follow. First part, and probably the one that will take more time, is laying down the basics, so know that you know enough of the syntax and the semantics of the language to be able to follow for the other two parts, which is probably where the interesting stuff comes. So how to do numerics in Python, how to do plotting, how to do data analysis and statistics. Okay, first step is to make sure that every one of you has access to the notebook server. So if you are connected to the address indicated in the sheet, you will see a login form like this. Please use the credentials written on the sheet of paper and log in. And once you're in, you should see basically sort of file manager. The part for this talk is here in Python intro. Sorry, I wonder why there should be the slides in here, but they're not. Moment you should get this file. That's the slides that are going to show for part one, Python basics. And these are the exercise sheets, and other two parts are just on the notebook without slides. So feel free to open the slides and or the first notebook to follow along. Everybody's good so far? Got to this point? Anyone having troubles? Okay, looks like not. Great. So, let's start. Python is an interpreted language. What this means is you type comments in, you get immediately feedback and a result. So, there's no separate compilation step. You can type the comments at the Python shell in the terminal, or you can type the comments in the notebook. So the notebook is particularly convenient because it allows you to mix Python code, text, and graphics. And then you can save it, restore, and continue your analysis. And the way you interact with the notebook, new one. It's just typing a comment here. This is the code cell. Then you can press Control Enter to run that comment or evaluate the cell. That's the way they say in the notebook context. Another useful shortcut is Alt-Enter, which runs the code and immediately opens another cell for entering more code. This is also convenient if the notebook is asynchronous, so if the code here takes some time, you can already type the next step while the computer computes. As for the syntax, Python is made of statements and expressions, which are so-called logical lines. The line is normally ended by the end-of-line character. So you press Enter, that's a line sent to the interpreter for running. If you want to spread a command across multiple lines, you just end the line with a backslash. So this basically means, okay, forget this end of line and continue. Notebooks and shell prompts will signal this with three dots. nothing strange. Strings in Python are delimited by quotes, either double quotes or single quotes. No difference. Or you can add a triple double quote or a triple single quote, and that delimits a string that can extend over several lines. So you can have in Python a string that really a complete paragraph of text or a template for creating a file, and that's a single string constant. Operators for combining for doing operations on strings, numbers, and other types. The usual arithmetic operators, comparison operators, and these ones are the logical operators. They are really spelled in English, no abbreviations, so no double ampersand, for instance. Okay, so first exercise on notebook. Within 1 minute, how much is 2 raised to the power 38? Start multiplying. Results. Okay, so the only problem is what's the exponentiation operator, and that's a double star in Python. So 1 star multiplying, 2 stars raised to the power. By the way, please feel free to ask questions anytime. I presume that's the expectation, but it's always good to be clear. Okay. Yes?
What's the double smaller than or bigger than?
Shift. Arithmetic shift or logical shift.
I don't know what that means.
Shift means you have a number represented in binary, and you shift the binary digits, one to the left and one to the right, and pad with a zero. Okay, operators can have, so the right term is can be overloaded. So they can do things that are beyond their normal scope. So for instance, multiplication operator can be applied to strings. So you can repeat a certain string by just multiplying it, or you can concatenate strings by adding them. None of them are overloaded. For instance, you cannot divide a string. But other nice things you can do with strings is plug other values inside. So this is a way of sort of creating a template. You have a string, and then you have these placeholders that are curly brackets with number in it, and then you apply this format operator, and this plus number 20 here and number 1001 here. Instead of the numbers, you can use names And then in this case, format takes the names instead of the, so relies on the names instead of the numbers. And then you can give the names in any order. So here, order must match. Here, names must match, and order is not important. Variables are created by assigning a value to them. An assignment is done with a single equal sign. By contrast, comparison, so checking two objects for equality, that's done with a double equal sign. This is checking for equality. And this is an error because this is the assignment operator and one is not a variable. And there's a number of shortcuts. So if you've done C or Java programming, these are already known to you. If not, just think of them as shortcuts. The important, absolutely important thing to remember about Python variables is that Python variables are names for values. So if you do this thing, say assign this string, give it the name A, and then write the statement B equal A, you are not copying the string. You are not copying whatever object is here into another location of memory. It's just giving a different name to the same string. I will show you later how this can have sometimes unexpected consequences, but bear in mind, variables are just, are not even variables in a sense, they're just names that you give to objects. And if you want to check if two names are referring to the same object, this is is operator. So if this is true, if two variables refer point to the same object, are the same thing. So if this is true, modifying one will modify the other. Function calls, like most other languages, use mathematical notation, function name, parentheses, and then arguments in between. And you can see from these examples that these basic functions allow you to convert types. So you have a string with the number 42, you want to get the number 42 out of it, you apply the function called int. If you instead you want to convert this to a floating point number instead of an integer, use a function called float. Likewise, str, this the Python name for a string, works as a function to convert numbers or other things to string. Python has also variadic functions, means functions that take a variable number of arguments. This comes handy for instance if you want to take minimum or maximum or the sum of a list or a set of numbers. And if you need to remember only one function, then remember this function help. And now it's time for going back to the notebook and see what help does. Which is relatively simple, just prints the help. So Python has an online help system, every function in interpreter has some help. Not all how texts are readable. This is not a joke on the IT crowd. If you Google, then the internet explodes, but something like this. So the help text for the help function is not that useful. I mean, to understand this, you need to be already pretty advanced in Python. But the basic functions all have meaningful help text. Of course, the interesting part comes when we can define our own functions. And that's the way to do it. Def, function name, and then parameter list in parentheses. And this is the column here. This is a thing that people coming from other languages always forget. So def, name, parameters, column. So columns are ubiquitous in Python. Yes?
Good question. If I write a function and I want it to have a help text, is it just printing the doc string, or how do
yes,
I...
Yes, it's printing the doc string.
Just the doc string, nothing else.
Okay, this is the body of the function. Here the important part is that the body of the function, so what's executed when you call this function, is not delimited by braces or begin-end tags of any way. It's delimited by indentation. So Python forces you to properly indent your code. So indentation is not just aesthetics in Python. It really defines your program. So in this case, the function starts. So you see that you have indented two spaces. So all the part that's indented two spaces, that's the body of the function. When you go back the dent, so back to the same level where the def is, the function body has ended. And the columns, the column there. So whenever indentation increases, you need to have a column. No column, indentation increases, syntax error. Comments are done like this with the hash sign. And of course, you call a function defined by you, just like built-in functions. So name, parentheses, parameters. Okay, and this was really the topic of the question. But then if you have this thing here, it's called the doc string, and that's the help text. Okay, now quick exercise just to get you acquainted with typing Python code in the notebook. Just do it. Type the function and run it. Yes. Try it. We'll, I assure you, your computer will not explode. You will get an error, but it's interesting to see what error you get. Okay. Things to check. So the editor, the code editor in the notebook already knows that colons are tied to indentation, so whenever you type a colon, will indent automatically for you. So it helps you getting the code flow right. And can you suggest another way I could have done this instead of string formatting? Yes?
Name it. Saying hello, colon, whatever name, and then whatever name equals.
Yeah, but then I need to construct a string that has hello as the first part and the name as the second part. So the problem is how you combine the two.
You could have added them with the plus operator.
You can add them. So coming to the question before, what happens if we change here? So instead of a string, we send a number to the function. So in this case, nothing happens. And that's an important feature of Python. So Python does not restrict types of variables. So there's no typing on parameters, there's no typing on variables. So you see, there's no type specification here. For a reason, the type is not checked. So instead of a string, we can send a number, we can send a file, another object. It can be that the code is such that it can accept another type. So in this case, format will happily take a number and plug that number here in the string. But if I now change the function, and do this instead. So instead of format, I use addition. With string, works. With a number, we get an error. You cannot add a string and a number. No typing, no checks, means the code is somewhat more flexible, but sometimes you have to deal with it in the form of these weird errors that pop out of nowhere, and it means that a function was expecting something different from what you gave it. For the record, Python 3 has optional type checking. So if you start with programming in Python 3, you can actually tell the interpreter that this should be a string, and then you would get a warning, at least, that you have given a number where a string was expected. Questions? Okay. Function can have default values. So in that case, you can omit the parameter. And also, you can call the functions like we did for format before. You can call the function with unordered list of arguments, and then parameters are assigned by order, like in almost every other programming language. Or you can pass parameters by name. And in this case, the order does not matter. Names matter, order does not. And of course, functions are interesting because they compute something and return this result to the caller. And the return statement is done for that. So you compute a result somehow, and then return means that the caller, the function that called your function, gets that result and can store it in a variable or not. And of course, when return is executed, interpreter leaves the function. So in this case, for instance, after the return, this statement would never be executed. Okay, conditionals, if, else if, and else. Else if must be abbreviated to elif, one word. Again, look that there are, so the blocks, so the extent of instructions that should be executed in the if branch are delimited by indentation, not by braces or other tags. So after the if comes a colon, and then a block of indented code. Hash, there's no and if, there's only indentation. While has a similar syntax. While, evaluate an expression, and while this expression is true, run this block of code here, indented. Colon, indented. Okay, so next exercise. Modify this function and have it print welcome back if the name is brainhack. Have guessed. The thing is, we just insert an if branch here. What's the operator for comparing two values, for checking if they are equal?
Double equal.
Yeah, exactly. So if break hack. Then print welcome back. Sorry. So this is the structure: if indented block, else indented block. Okay, in order to do any program that's more than probably a few hundred lines long, you need to bracket in several files. These files are called modules in Python, and you can read, say, the functions that are defined in a different file by using this import statement. Note that import is executed only once, so you may have different import statement and import the same module over and over again, but only the first one will actually do something. The other ones, so basically on the first run, it will be cached in memory, and then a cache copy is reused. After importing a module, functions defined in that module are available but must be prefixed with the name of the module. So if function greet is defined in module hello, then in your code you must call it hello.greet, not just greet. If you want to avoid having the prefix, there's a slightly different version. So from hello import greet, this will make greet function available as greet without any prefix there. If any of you is familiar with R, this is the default behavior in R, for instance. It's not the default behavior in Python. Okay, and then let's say the purpose of this first part would be to show you enough Python to be able to read a file and do limited parsing. Read lines from a file, split the string, and convert to integer or something like that, more precisely. So we need a few data structures. Python has already quite good set built in or available in the standard library. There's lists, so ordered sequences of things which you can modify. Tuples, same as strings, but you cannot modify them after creation. There's strings. There's a wealth of other data structures in the standard library, dictionaries, ordered dictionaries, heaps, structures, queues, not so often used. What probably is more important to you for the use of Python is these two things. So the array and the data frame. The array is not part of standard Python, comes from a library called NumPy, and it's a one or multi-dimensional array of numbers, so vector, a matrix, or a higher order tensor. And the implementation is quite fast. So it has a Python interface, but really the C code underneath. So if you can use the functions provided from NumPy, you will not suffer a large performance penalty. Similarly, data frame comes from this library called Pandas. It's very similar to the data frames that you have in R, for instance, and basically is a table. So a set of columns with names, so columns and rows, and columns have names and rows have indices. So that's what the data frame is. We'll see more details later. So lists. List is an ordered sequence of things that you can mutate, you can modify it. Lists are created with these square brackets. Square bracket and then a list of items separated by a comma. You can append items to a list. So if L is a list, L.append will append this item to the list. And list need not be homogeneous. So you can create a list of items, whatever. You can mix numbers, characters, strings, and possibly other lists or other objects in the same data structure. More generally, Python has a concept of sequences, which is anything that you can iterate, actually anything that can be subscripted in this way. So you can say, okay, give me the first item of the sequence, so you start counting from zero, first item, second item, third item. This works for lists, works for strings, and for a number of other data structures. The syntax is the same. So Python knows that this is a string, and in this case it means take the second character from the string. And all sequences support this len function that returns the length. So how many items are there? Note that since you start counting from zero, this is not a valid index in the sequence. So it's one past the end of the sequence because of the zero base. And important, these built-in functions, sum, min, max, they work on lists also, not just on strings. So I can write max, so not just on tuples of arguments. So I can write that max, give the argument a list, and we'll return the maximum of that list, maximum item of that list. And that's, I think, now time for this exercise, number 6. Write a function to average, to compute the mean value of a list of numbers. Again, user-defined function, so it starts with def. And we have one argument, that's the list. Well, that's a simple computation. So we need to compute something and return it to the caller. So return, what do we return? Well, the mean is the sum divided by the number of items. And the number of items is given by len function. Does this look okay? Sequences support slicing. That means you cannot, you can access a single item, so like S0, that would be the first character in this string, but you can access more than that. 0 to 4, that means the first 0, 1, 2, 3. 4 is excluded. So in Python, there's this convention that when you have an interval, the first index is included and the last is excluded. So this thing takes a substring of Zurich, just first 4 characters, works with strings, works with lists, works with any sequence, potentially, including NumPy arrays, which we'll see. You can also use this syntax for accessing an element of the string, not just to get the element out of the list, but to modify it. So you can assign values to a place in a list. You cannot do the same thing in a string. So a string is immutable, meaning you cannot alter characters in the string. And there's a lot of functions available for operating on lists, on strings. Each has its own set of functions that support it. I've listed some that are more or less daily use for appending items, inserting items at certain positions, removing. But there's the online reference, consult it. The other point is that we have seen this notation with the dot. So that's the object notation for Python. So Python is a object-oriented programming language in its core. So everything is an object, literally everything. So this thing basically means call this function on this object. So functions defined on objects are called methods, but they are really functions with an additional parameter, and that additional parameter is the object being operated upon. So in a sense, this means call the extend function on here. So it's this is almost the same thing as writing these are virtually the same thing, but Python has this special notation because this is an object, so that gives this function additional properties, which we are not going to cover today. Again, some operators are overloaded for lists. You can sum list, which means concatenation, or you can extend a list plus equal that adds item at the end. And now we come to for loops. So the syntax is what you expect now. So for variable in something, indented column, indented block. The important thing that distinguishes Python from other programming languages is that for loops run over any sequence. So there are languages that constrain you to run a for loop on integers. So for I from 1 to 10. Not true in Python, this can be any sequence. This is the way to say for I running from 0 to 3 included. So 4 is excluded. But you can substitute any list here, and the for loop will work the same. Of course, these things need not be in any particular order, need not be numbers. You can use any sequence, so you can use a string, and that gives you iterates over the characters. And if you want to force a particular order, there's these two functions, sorted and reversed, which make the for loop run into ascending or descending order. Okay, now time for a couple more exercises. Seven and eight, this would take a bit more time. So the statement is probably more readable to you. They're on the notebook. So write two functions, one that takes a list of numbers and returns a list of the odd numbers. So factor out, filter out the even numbers. And the other one that takes a list and a number and returns the absolute differences of every element in the list with that number. I don't know why the slides are cut.
Basically, Python, you don't need to close the for loop or while loop.
No, it's just indentation. You didn't, and that's it.
If I want, for example, to make a nested loop, how can I?
You indent.
You just move.
Yeah. So, you want to write this function that builds a list. So we have a list, an input list here, and we want to build an output list. So we start with the empty output list. So bracket, open bracket, close, nothing in between, so that's an empty list. Now we can do a for loop. For item x in list L. And basically we want to append x to the output list, but only if x is odd. Okay, I'm testing. Okay, sorry, I called the function odd and then I wrote the test for even. It's odd if divided by 2, there's a rest of 1. And that's basically it. The only thing we need to do at the end is being sure to return the result. Okay, now of course this is wrong. The odd numbers in 1, 2, 3 are 1 and 3. Does it look convincing? Yep.
See, this works for the segments in 1 to 3 equals 2 divided by 2 equals 1, but what if you want none of this is not? I don't quite understand the if statement.
The if statement is if x divided by 2 is 1. So,
yeah,
integer. It's not divided. This is a modulus. So the remainder of the integer division. Okay, and now the good news is that exercise 8 is basically the same thing. So we have to build an output list. So we do it by running through the items in L, except in this case there's no if. Just append the absolute deviation. So, see what we've done. Start with the result list, walk through items in the input list, and for each item in the input list, add the desired result into the Are there questions? Okay. It turns out that this pattern of constructing functions that operate on lists, of doing a while loop with a nested if or so, is so common that there are functions for doing exactly that. These two functions, map and filter, do exactly what we have done now. So map takes a list, L, and a function, F, and applies F to every element of L, and returns the resulting list. Filter takes a list, L, and a function, F, and then returns the list of items in L, unmodified, but for which, over which the function f is true. So this function should be something that returns a boolean, so 0 or 1. And wherever this function returns non-zero, then you take the item and return it. And there's a third variant to the pattern, and it's called reduce. And so map and filter take a list, output a list. Reduce takes a list and a function and returns a number or an object more generally. And works like this. You take the first two items in the list, combine them using the function. Then you take the result of this evaluation and the third item, and you combine them using the function. And then you take the result and the fourth item in the list and combine them. So on. And when there are no more items, return the result. And this is the beginning of, let's say, a programming style that's called functional programming, which is a big topic. I'm not getting into it. There are good introductions on the web. But the thing that's probably important here, why I mentioned these functions, is that map, filter, and reduce, they are ubiquitous in NumPy and Pandas. So they are the only way of doing efficiently this kind of things with these kind of loops, operations, and lists in NumPy and Pandas. And this is how you could rewrite the exercise 7 and 8 using filter and map. So filter and map basically reduce your problem to just writing the function that picks the right element. Same mistake here. Or does the correct munging with elements of the list. This also shows that you can define functions within functions. So functions in Python need not be defined at top level. So you can have a local function delta that's visible only within this function deviation. It's not visible outside. Yes?
Do you always have to define that function which you pass as an argument to map and filter? Or
yeah.
Can you just kind of create it as a sort of anonymous function?
There's a lambda form in Python, but it's very limited. It's not a complete anonymous function. It's just limited to an expression. It's
so
a parametric
you
expression.
A lambda in there.
You could stick a lambda here, yes. Okay, now we're nearing the end. File processing. This is the typical pattern for processing a file. You open the file with this with statement. With open as, and this is the name by which you can refer to the file within this block. Again, colon, indentation, so the instructions for processing the file are here and are indented. And then you can do a for loop over the open file, and that loops over the lines if it's a text file. If it's a binary file, loops over the characters. Open takes two parameters, file name, and then a string indicating how you want to open the file. The string is either R for reading, W for writing, A for appending, which means write but start at the end of the file. If you want to open for read and write, just append plus. So R plus means read and write, W plus means read and write, and they have different initial position. The with statement is actually more general than just opening files. I will not get into it. In Python, it's called a context manager. So what the with does is whenever execution leaves this block, the file is automatically closed. There are more things that you may want to close or in general release when you leave a block of code, and that's the general purpose of with. There are also methods on the file object, which you can use for reading the whole file in memory at once. So no processing of the lines, just summon it up all in memory. Let's read. Or you can get a list of the lines, and that's read lines. And this is a recall what we have seen on type conversions. These functions can be used to convert between types, strings to integers, integers to strings or floats. And that takes up to us to the next exercise, which is write a small parser that reads this file. This file just contains numbers, and out of this file you should get a list of numbers. Let me start by copying the template. Okay, yeah, we want a list as a result, so let's start by initializing the list. Then you can have a look at the values file here. So you see it's just numbers, one per line, so extremely simple. So now here we know that line is a string containing a number, right? So we can get the number out by just converting the string to a number. Now again, append number to list as we've done before. So build the list piecewise. And finally return the list that we have built. Questions?
So now this list of values is somewhere in the memory. And if we change one of these fields, what happens to the initial one? Somewhere in the memory, because we said that they want.
Yes, so exactly. The variables are just names for the list. There's one list. If you change that list, all the variables that, so all the names for that list will change.
But the initial value will just remain somewhere like not in the memory.
No, mutable means that you change the value. Okay, now let me just skip this. There's a number of operations you can do on strings, on file system, and there's a long list. I think I've included references to online things. Let me skip the dictionaries as they are not that important for the rest. Dictionaries are just mappings. So from a key value, so from a key to value. In a sense, so if you think of the dictionary analogy as this is the word and this is the definition, in mathematical terms, this would be a function, this is a value in the domain, and this is value in the codomain. You can access the keys, so the words or the domain, the value, the keys function, or the codomain, the values function and loop over it. And last topic from the basics is exceptions. So exceptions are Python's standard way of signaling errors. We have already seen a couple where before we were passing like a number to the greet function and it raises a type error. And we have seen also, no, that was, but for instance, typical error, you close a file and then still try to read or write to it. And then you get this thing, traceback, lines, and then in the end, you get the line that tells you what the error is. There are two parts important in this line. The last part, so after the column comes the message. This is meant for users to read. It's a human readable explanation of what happened, or better, why it didn't work. Before the column, this part is for Python, for the programming side. So this is the class of the exception. Different errors have different classes. Why are they important? Because you can catch them and take appropriate action. And this is the way to do it. This is called a try except block. So you have code that could possibly go awry. You prefix it with try. If some error happens, then Python will check the except clauses after. It's kind of an if. So think of it, if error happens and if error is some exception, then do this. If error class is another exception, then do this. That's the basic pattern. And you have an optional clause called finally, which will be executed regardless. So whether the error occurred or not, code here will get executed. And you can, of course, use the same mechanism in your code and raise an error with the raise function, so statement. And the syntax is raise, error class, and then the message. Let's skip this exercise, because I would like to move to the other sections. Last thing is exactly how it happens that variables So you see that the same variables are just names. You start with a list here, give it another name B, then alter B, and A is altered too. That's because A and B are just names for this object here. And in the slides you have kind of animation of what happens when you go through the Python code. Okay, are there more questions? Otherwise we move to the second. Yes.
So how do I make a backup of my list, for example?
So that really depends on the object. So the objects in the standard library, so list, tuples, dictionaries, have, so there's a function called copy, which takes a copy. Other objects will have their own methods. Objects from NumPy and Pandas also support a copy method. So you call object.copy and that takes a copy. Now there's an issue when you have nested data structures, like a list containing other lists. Does the copy go all the way down, or does it stop at the first level? This is, so a copy that just copies the outside list and not the internal elements is called a shallow copy, and one that goes down is called a deep copy. And Python's standard copy is a shallow copy, and there's a deep copy function when you want to go deep. Just check the copy module in the standard library and there's a good explanation there. More questions? Okay, then time to open the second part, NumPy. This was an attempt of getting slides out of the notebook and completely failed. NumPy is the standard package for doing numerical analysis, numerical processing in Python. So at the core, NumPy is a library that provides you with matrix vector elements or multidimensional numerical arrays and functions to operate on them. And the cool thing about NumPy is that it has automatic vectorization. So you can say array, so vector plus vector, and it will do element-wise thing. We will see that in a moment. But really allows you to write Python code as you would write mathematics on a sheet of paper, or as close as possible, let's say. So since NumPy is not built in, need to import it. NP is the standard abbreviation for that. And the NumPy array can be constructed with a function NumPy array. You can give to this function any sequence and will convert that sequence into an array. Normally for large data, you will not be doing this. You will rather be reading the data from file. So there are functions in NumPy for reading or saving arrays to disk, which can use a text-based format, a binary format proprietary of NumPy, or can read MATLAB's MAT format. So what we have seen about accessing items in list work also for NumPy elements. So this is the first item in the array. This is a slice of the first three elements. And you can set an item. So arrays are mutable, but in contrast to lists, arrays can only hold one data type. So you can create a list of numbers, strings, objects, whatever. You come to that with arrays. Arrays have a fixed data type, and you specify this data type when you construct the array. Also note that the data type, can influence what happens when you try to set a number. So this was constructed as an array of integers. So when I try to plug floating point number in this position, it gets converted to an integer silently. If you want to force an array to be of a particular type, then this is the syntax. In an NP array, you just add the type as an additional parameter. And there's a list of types in the NumPy documentation. Okay, I thought that it would be probably more expressive to just show what the arrays do on plotting the numbers instead of just doing mathematical operations. So basically, there is one standard library for plotting in Python. It's called matplotlib. There are alternatives, but they are kind of niche. So this is the library that almost everyone uses. Has provision for doing all kinds of plots, but being so large, it's also very complicated not complicated to use, but the documentation is complicated to navigate. There's really hundreds of methods, and pinpointing which one is one you are looking for is hard. So people are doing libraries that basically are easier layers on top of matplotlib. Seaborn is one of those. It's mainly aimed at statistical plotting, but also really provides a statics layer over matplotlib with more pleasantly looking defaults. And for simple plots, it has simple functions. So it just says seaborn, bar plot, done. You have a bar plot. Not so easy in matplotlib. Okay, and now we can check this. So load the libraries for plotting, create an array. This A range is a different function for creating array. Basically creates an array with numbers that go from this to this, stepping this third number. So this will have the array of 40 numbers going from 0 to 4, equally spaced 0.1. Another function for creating arrays is npOnce. Just give it the length and we'll return an array of ones. There's a similar function, zeros, and return an array of fixed length, zero. And well, now we can plot. PLT plot is a way of doing a line plot. What goes on the x-axis, what goes on the y-axis. And that's, of course, since y1 is just an array of ones, we get a straight horizontal line. Now we can try a different way of constructing arrays. Bin space is similar to a range, so creates an array that goes from this starting number to this starting number, but instead of giving the increment, you give the number of subdivisions. So how many items should be in the array? This makes it particularly suitable in this case. So we have already the axis, and we would like to have that exact number of points to plot. You can see array. Okay, now this is in line with some slope. What if I want to combine the two? So make a plot with two lines. This is where things get a bit more complicated in Matplotlib. I'm afraid there's no time for doing the exercise now, but I will just show you the solution. There's, you need to get two objects out of Matplotlib, so define a subplot object. This consists of a figure and a list of axes. And so the figure is the canvas where you draw, and the axes are the individual plots. And then on the axis, you can say, now, x, plot this, so make a line plot of y1 and make a line plot of y2. Here we go. Yes.
But in this case, it's not really necessary, right? You could just call plt.plot and plt.plot, and you could just hold the plot open as long as you don't display it.
That doesn't work in the notebook.
Oh, okay.
So because the notebook shows the plot as soon as you do it. Okay, now this is the part that probably makes NumPy interesting. So you can define arrays. We have seen variables, but now we can operate on them. And all the arithmetic operations are overloaded to do element-wise operation. So array of A, array of B, as long as they have the same length. C will be the sum. So 1 plus this plus this. This plus this. This plus this. So just as you write vector algebra. And you, as a special case, you can also do this with numbers. In this case, the number gets promoted to a constant vector of the desired length, which we can see in the plot. So we add, here we are adding 1 to all the points in y2, and we are subtracting 1 to all points in y2. See that in the plot. This is y2, ya above, and line below. Okay, no time for really doing this, but how would you do it? So what's the key insight here? If you wanted to plot function 1 over x, assuming that we already have x, that's a fixed array interval. just like this, and that will work. This will do element-wise reciprocal of items in X. And all we have seen so far works with multidimensional arrays, so matrices. The way you create matrices from fixed data is by giving a list of lists, and then each of these becomes a row of the matrix. See? Multidimensional, well, all arrays, not just multidimensional, have a notion of the shape. Shape is basically the, it's a tuple with number of places, and the shape is the dimension. So for a matrix dimension 2, there's 2. And this is the length in each direction. So how many rows, how many columns? If we had a three-dimensional array, there would be 3 places with the indices. So it's a kind of generalized length. Can mutate matrices. The only difference is you have to use a multi-index. So instead of a number, say this place in the vector, place number 3 has to be altered, you have to use an index with commas. So place I, comma j has to be altered. Transpose is taken with this T. So matrix dot capital T. In fact, Python distinguishes between capital and small letters. Transpose is the matrix. And the last topic on NumPy is how we do multiplication. Basically, there's one operator for doing matrix, vector, matrix, matrix, or vector, vector, dot product, and that's called NPy dot. So if you call, well, these are two vectors of the canonical basis of the plane. NPy dot of two vectors is the dot product of the vectors, which in this case we expect to be 0, and 1 is the self product. But then if you apply NPy dot to a matrix and a vector, you get the matrix applied to that vector. You would get back vector if the server is not stopped. Okay. Yeah. And if you use NPy dot two matrices, that's the matrix-matrix product. Okay, last thing that I want to mention in passing is that this automatic promotion of operators on arrays to do element wise applies also to functions. So functions defined in NumPy can be applied to an array, so vector, matrix, tensor, and they work element wise. Which means, for instance, that you can write things like this, and they define arrays. So X is an array, the interval that we define at the beginning. I have only slot 1, but Okay, I'm sorry I ran out of time. Are there more questions? Okay, if not, then there's the third notebook available on the server, covers pandas. So how to do table manipulation and a bit of statistics.